So can a debt buyer really collect a debt against you? That's a question that we get a lot. Hey, I appreciate you watching this video. My name is John Watts. I'm a consumer protection lawyer. And a big part of my practice is dealing with these debt buyers, these companies that at least claim to have bought a debt. And they'll tell you that they bought it, but is it true? And do they have the right to collect? And does it make a difference if they bought it or they did not buy your debt? So let's start off with just what in the world is a debt buyer. These are companies like Midland Funding, Midland Credit Management, LVNV Funding, Portfolio Recovery. They claim that they have gone out and bought up massive amounts of debt. And they might be paying 5 cents on the dollar, 7 cents on the dollar. And they don't buy, you know, one credit card debt. They buy $100 million worth of debt at any one time. And they'll pay $5 million, $7 million, whatever they pay for it. So what do they do with that debt? Well, a few of them will then try and sell that for a profit. So it's kind of like buying a stock, you know, say, well, if I can buy it for $5 a share and then turn around and sell it for $7 a share, I've made money. But by and large, what these companies do is they then start collecting it. Now, they may collect it personally. In other words, Portfolio Recovery will have somebody who works for Portfolio Recovery call you. Portfolio Recovery will write you a letter. And they will credit report. Other times these companies will buy the debt, or at least they claim to. So let's take LVNV Funding. But they don't really have employees there. So they'll then farm it out to either related companies or other companies to then actually make the phone calls, write the letters, that type of thing. Now, in that example, LVNV itself will credit report on you. So that's how they do it. So that leads us to the question, do they have the right to collect? Well, here's what it all comes down to. Do they own the debt? And do you owe the debt? Because if you do not owe the debt, then they could have the best proof that they actually bought the debt, but it's meaningless because you don't owe it. So we'll deal with the company, let's say a debt buyer, and we beat them in trial. And then they turn around and sell it to another debt buyer. And let's say that second debt buyer absolutely owns a debt and they come after us. Is that legal? No, because we do not owe that debt. There's no debt owed. We won at trial. That's the proof. We don't owe any debt. So what about the more common situation where they say, now, did you have a Capital One, you know, debt of $3,000? And we say, yeah, I had a Capital One account. You know, I don't know the exact amount, but somewhere in that neighborhood. Well, then the question is, do they actually own it? So when Midland Funding writes you or calls you, do they actually own the debt? How about LVNV, Portfolio, Calvary? I mean, there's dozens and dozens of these companies. Jefferson Capital. So do they really own it? Well, to ultimately prove they own it, they need to show the contract. And we talked about this in a video about the completeness doctrine. It's a rule of evidence that if they introduce part of a document into trial, they need to introduce the entire document. So a lot of times they'll send you the bill of sale. They go, see, this proves it. Well, the bill of sale is just a small part of a bigger document called the purchase agreement. So in trial, we've been very successful to say, no, you have to produce the entire purchase agreement so we can see what did you buy, what representations were made, what did you agree to do or not to do? Because, see, sometimes what they truly bought is not our debt. Well, that's a problem. Sometimes the representations by the seller of the debt are, hey, we make no promise, no representation that anything we're giving you is remotely accurate. That's why you're buying it for like 5 cents on the dollar. But then other times they'll buy the debt and it'll say, but you have to agree not to sue. Well, obviously that's a big deal. If they promise not to sue, that's how they bought the debt. And now they're turning around suing us. It's a bit of a problem for them. And so we want to see that entire agreement, and they never want to reveal that. So it's easier when you've been sued, kind of ironically, but it's easier when you've been sued to fight this because they're the ones that sued you. They have to prove, you know, you've sort of heard about proof and, you know, preponderance of the evidence, or we have to sort of tilt the scales of justice. Well, their obligation is to tilt the scales of justice in their favor. They have to put evidence to do that. Well, if they don't provide the right evidence, then you win. But how about if they're just calling you? Can you answer the phone and say, you must send me the purchase agreement? Well, I mean, you can say that. I can almost guarantee you that they will never send that to you. And most courts will not require them to do that. Now, what about they write you a letter? We could send a validation request back. This is under Section 1692G of the Fair Debt Collection Practices Act, and say, hey, I don't think you guys own this debt. Send me proof. Send me a copy of the purchase agreement where you claim to have bought my debt. Now, they won't do that. They'll send you the bill of sale. They'll send you an affidavit. They'll send you some other things. Then you can reply back. Look, the bill of sale, it says it's part of the purchase agreement. Send me the purchase agreement. Now, at the end of the day, most judges won't require them to actually send you the purchase agreement in order for them to call you, write you, or credit report. But what you're doing is laying the foundation. First of all, you're disputing this debt. And if they don't mark your credit report as disputed, that's a big problem for them under the FDCPA, Fair Debt Collection Practices Act, Section 1692E8 says if a consumer disputes a debt, they must mark it as disputed. So that's part of what you're laying the foundation for. But then also if they sue you, and they almost always say in the lawsuits, and the consumer, the defendant, you've never disputed this, and it's clear we're supposed to win. You're like, hey, wait a minute. I disputed it. Here are all these letters I wrote you about. Give me the purchase agreement. You have not given me the purchase agreement. And then when you're at trial and they don't have the purchase agreement, a lot of judges will look at that and say, that's just not right. I mean, you know, you claim portfolio recovery that you own this debt, and this lady asked you, you know, 3-4 times for it, and now you show up in my court and you don't even have the purchase agreement? You know, and so that can help you. Now, there's another strategy of not asking for it until you're at trial, okay? And I won't get into all the details of which is better or when is one better than the other. I'm just saying that if we're asking the question, does this debt buyer have the right to collect against me? Then we need to know, do I owe the debt and do they own the debt? And ultimately at trial is where they better prove that they own the debt. At least that's the position I've taken for many, many years. So hope this is helpful to you. And let me know if you have any questions just in general, and we can do some follow-up videos, or I'll try to answer those questions in the comments. And I appreciate you guys watching. Have a great day. All right. Bye-bye.